constantly living in the future. Another country that had sudden wealth is Dubai. Emirates. It's gas. Giant deposits of natural gas. 2 years ago, Dubai built a ski slope. It's the hottest place in the world. They have to import the snow. They have to import the ice. So countries can be wise and not wise. Yes,
ma'am. What about Japan?
That's another country. Go to Japan today. It's the most civil, polite, honest country you could find. And yet for 100 years they completely wiped, tried their damnedest to dominate all of Asia and treated them worse than animals. And then nothing like that. Nothing like that today. So wisdom can come and go.
What about their sense of everything, specifically their sense of fairness and equality?
Which they have now. Oh yeah, well that's another thing, yeah. The president of Japan, excuse me, the CEO of Honda. Any of you own Hondas? Nice cars, right? The constitution of that firm says the CEO can't earn more than 20 times what the janitor earns. It's in the company laws. 20 times. When General Motors went down, and you and I had a bank, you know, bail them out, the CEO of GM was earning 720 times more than the janitor, as a tremendous failure. Honda's a very successful firm. Different sort of thing. That's a big signal. One of the things that works in organizations to inculcate wisdom, and something we should talk about, is signals. Hierarchy, people in positions of authority, and we still have some people, send signals by their actions. So if you're a greedy SOB, which sort of, I've met a number of CEOs, almost all of them, that's how you get to rise up in American firms. You have to be ruthless and astoundingly greedy. So the signal goes out, that's the way to be, that's the way to succeed. In most firms, not all, but in most firms. So let's talk about this again. Someone made a great comment, this Australian guy, and it was working for the World Health Organization at the beginning of the Iraqi War. He said to me that you Americans, he was sort of joking, you guys are really crazy. You're the only country in the world that would try to turn Afghanistan into Norway. Which is both pathetic and true. So, let me tell you one other very interesting. There's a very good book called Why Countries Fail, by two guys at MIT, James Robinson and his first name is Asimoglu, he's a Turkish guy. And it's a very readable book. They wrote this for the public, and they start off the book with a very interesting thing. Let's talk about Nogales. Where's Nogales?
Mexico.
And Arizona. There's two cities by that name that are right across the Rio Grande River. One is in Mexico, and one is in Arizona. The one in Arizona is pretty prosperous. It looks a little like Tucson. It's hot as the devil, but if you don't mind the heat, it's a nice place, you know, it's reasonably. The one in Mexico is a disaster. Same climate, same geography, same people. Nogales in Arizona, pretty heavily Spanish. Everything's the same, but one's in the United States and one's in Mexico. In the United States, at least until recently, I hope it's, laws are enforced. Institutions work. You can go to the courts. The police is somewhat under control. I don't want to get into current events, but at least it seems that way. That's not true in Mexico. It's getting that way. I don't want to condemn Mexico in any way. But for a long time, it was fairly lawless. There's a lot of criminality. The courts can be fairly corrupt. So that made all the difference. One country was run in a wise way, and one wasn't. And the cities, which have almost exact mirror images of one another, in all the ways we try to think of what makes a country prosperous, what makes a difference is just that, is the laws, the institutions, and the way people act. We'll talk more about this next time we meet. But how do you act? Think about Nogales. Okay, so that's all I wanted to talk to you today about. The last thing, the theme of that book, Robinson and Asimoglu, is countries have a ratio of extraction and enablement. They use two words, extraction and enablement, a ratio. Some countries are almost 100% extraction. So a small ruling elite extract all the wealth and spend it on themselves. Mobutu, the head of Central Africa, he was on that. Jacob Zuma just about ruined South Africa, a country that's blessed by nature, by being astoundingly extracted. And they just take all the wealth. Enablement, countries where you don't do that, where the wealth is somewhat shared and everyone knows it, there's a sense of fairness. I just read to yesterday in The Economist magazine, there's only 7 countries that they now list as being real democracies. 7 in the whole world, and we're not one of them. We've fallen off the list. The less democracy you have, the more you get extraction, because the state gets controlled by the rich. You get an oligarchy or plutocracy, and it's a very bad road to go on if you believe in wisdom. The more you have democracy, it's harder to do that, because people have power, they can speak up. It's a very interesting thing. The fact that we've fallen off the list is not a good sign. That's a fairly objective study they do. And again, the usual culprits come out on top. Scandinavia, Northern Europe, Canada, and Australia. They throw in New Zealand. It's an interesting thing to think about. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to the leader.
Thank you, Larry. I'd like to introduce my friend Ram at the back there, who is doing the slides and the videoing. He and his wife Elena here, and they are both experts in making businesses run better and in artificial intelligence and all that. So it's probably I have the highest qualified TV operator ever.
Overqualified.
Okay. So I apologize, but because I only have so much time, I have to use slides. This is not a subject where slides are the appropriate medium. I'm not the first person to say it, but other people have said it. The power corrupts and PowerPoint corrupts absolutely. but there I am. I have to do it. So here, So I'm going to take you a tour of the origins. So this is the section on origins of this wisdom tradition that began about 6,000 to 8,000 years ago. All the dates and that I'm going to give you are always disputed by different scholars. So if you go to Wikipedia, you may find something totally different. This is what I was taught from my gurus, so I'm passing that. While that's coming on, let me just tell you that I'm going to cover a few sections today and in the next class. One is going to be the origins of the wisdom tradition. The second is going to be, I will choose a particular icon that we use to symbolize wisdom, and I'll decode that icon for you. So you'll see how the wisdom is encoded into icons. Thank you. Then I will talk to you about what wisdom says about life. And probably I will go into the next session. I may be able to do some of it today. Next conversation will be on the art of how to contact the world correctly, how to live in this world. I'll also talk about happiness and laughter and truth. That seems like a rich, ambitious. Okay. So wisdom, can you see this cartoon? Just says, we're out of milk, and the mother reacts, what? I'm sorry, I'll get some today. Are you angry? The father ignores it, and if you come to the right here.
I'm getting there.
The kid says, You have a lot to learn about parenting. Anyhow, we'll go to the next slide, please. Okay, there's a lot of focus on
it. It is. I will make it better.
I have to roll these over.
Can you see it?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the part of the world which is the Indian subcontinent.
I'll make it a little bigger, okay?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. So now you can see that there is, this is India. If you have been to India, you'll find Delhi is here, right here. Calcutta is to the south. Chennai is here, which where Ram is from, in further south here. Mumbai is here, so you can sort of locate yourself. Yeah, I think somebody had a friend up in Chandigarh, so that is up here.
Near the mountain?
Yeah, see, that's Chandigarh. So.
Bangalore.
Ah, Bangalore, so, you know, Bangalore here. So.
And you're from the A.M.
And I am from this place. And this figures, this town figures very largely in my wisdom story. We'll see why in a second.
What's the name of the town?
Allahabad. And the ancient times, it was founded in about 1800 BC. The ancient name of that town was Praya. If you want to remember all this, I'll email. Over here is a river called the Indus. Indus, I-N-D-U-S. You can't read it, Indus. And years ago, that is more than 4,000 years ago, there was another river here called the Saraswati River. Saraswati, don't remember it either. But a civilization developed in the Indus-Saraswati region, that is from where the wisdom tradition originated. Okay? So it is part of the Indus-Saraswati civilization, that's the origin. Now, it may appear that this is remote, but as I talk, I hope you realize, while it may be the wisdom of India, what I'm really talking about is your heritage. Because really, whatever, you know, we have this idea of world heritage buildings and so on, but knowledge and wisdom is world heritage, really. So it's your heritage. Now, it so happened in 1900 BC or so, that river dried up. We still know that the river was there from the aquifers and the settlements and so on. Up here is one of the oldest cities in the world, Mohenjo-daro. It's in Pakistan, that's around 4,000 years. Okay, now over here you'll see the Ganges River, you might have heard of that. And this river is called the Yamuna River, and they meet at this place, which is my hometown, Allahabad, which is distinguished by being a place of pilgrimage. Every year, about 2 million pilgrims descend on the city. Every 12 years, about 12 million pilgrims descend on the city for a month. And in 2000, which was the anniversary of 144th anniversary, 30 million pilgrims came to this city. Can you imagine that? There were no outbreaks of illnesses. So why did they come here? Because over here, people say if you bathe at the confluence of the river, where the two rivers meet, then you'll wash your sins away, you will get enlightenment, and you will be a different person. Of course, this is symbolic. This river, the Ganges, The river Yamuna stands for, is symbolic of knowledge, fast flowing river of knowledge.
Is it like the
Lady of Bangalore, or exactly. You go there to, you don't go there to visit a place, you go there so that you come back a different person. That's the idea of pilgrimage. The pilgrim, when he goes to a pilgrimage, is not the same pilgrim that returns. That's the idea of a pilgrimage. So this is the Yamuna River, which stands for knowledge. The Ganges River stands for love. So where the knowledge and love meet, a third river emerges, and we believe it's that same lost river called Saraswati. And Saraswati, in our tradition, is the goddess of wisdom. So where knowledge and love meet, That is where wisdom emerges. Something magical happens. That's the idea that I want you to remember. So we know what knowledge is. Let's begin with data. Data is a piece of fact. It's something that when we take a bunch of data, put them in a pattern, we get information. When we take information, we put purpose behind it, we end up with knowledge. When we take knowledge and we add love to it, we get, what do we get?
Wisdom.
So love is an essential ingredient of wisdom. Now, the people that developed these concepts, and I'll come to what those concepts are in a second, were called rishis. R-I-S-H-I-I-S. And the way they came about their insights was through what was called contemplation. So in that time, it was called contemplation. In Einstein time, it was called? Anybody know?
Meditation.
Thought experiment. Same thing, really, same thing. Know it, these are things, I mean, Einstein thought about the speed of light and how time and space were the same thing and how gravity was different from the way Newton thought about it. He was doing it all in his head. He was not running any experiments. The experiments followed 10 years later. He figured it out all in his head. So these were scientists, rishis, were thinking of. Incidentally, a little detail, the Greeks believed that Jews were descendants of rishis. Interesting little part there. Okay, so what they did was, once they had developed these thoughts were compiled into certain books by a person by the name of Vyasa. You may have heard this name. I'll give it all to you so you won't ever remember. He was the big editor. See, he edited it into four major books called the Vedas. This word we have come across, books of Veda. Books of knowledge and wisdom. And in the Veda was a part of the book called the Upanishad. You have to know these terms. But you don't have to write them down, I will send them to you. Upanishad, the Sanskrit and English come from the same Indo-European family. Upan means, it's very similar to upan or near. Shad is sit. So when a teacher says, come sit near me, I will teach you, that is when he's imparting wisdom. Because he's teaching to someone close to him, which means in a loving way. So no wisdom teacher, no guru can teach wisdom unless there's an element of love, unless there's a love or an exchange between the student and the teacher. That is the tradition. All right. I have to go to the next slide. So we did this. Wisdom is knowledge plus love. So we have to define what this term love means. So in our tradition, love means the dissolution of boundaries. So the mother and daughter love is that the mother does not make any distinction between herself and the child. There is no separateness of interest. Feels an identity with the child. That's our definition of love in the Vedantic sense. So what would be the opposite of love? Not hate. But
separation.
Separation.
But what?
Separation.
Separation. Division. So the opposite of love is division. What do we have in our country today?
Division.
Division. So we are beset with problems. So it's a very precise definition of what love is. All right. Now,